For the last couple days, I've been, trying to deliver this image that and this idea that technology without humanity is misdirected. I would also say that technology without science is hollow, and we need to constantly return to research to help inspire us, direct us, and also to validate the things we do. So a lot of our panels here at Xtech have been incredible entrepreneurs and people from the business community, the tech community that are driving the development, but we're also gonna continue to try to bring in more science for you to help create that foundation that drives all of this and creates the richness that we're looking for. So we have four speakers for you that have different perspectives from the scientific views on creativity and human performance. I think we're pretty much set up for our first. So over here is David Eagleman, who's a friend of mine. He sort of does it all, so he's a great one to start because he's a scientist now at Stanford, but also an entrepreneur, best-selling author, a TV host of PBS The Brain, and so I think this would be a great way to dive in with some scientific perspective on creativity and performance. Everyone, David Eagleman.
Great, thanks, Adam. All right, cool. All right, so I was asked to talk about learning and about creativity. So I'm going to talk about those at a very high level without any graphs or charts, just my view on that. And then in the final part, I'm going to talk about a very cool project that we're doing and use the first part as a lens for that. So you guys have heard lots about the brain this week and how massively complex it is. Every neuron is as complicated as the city of San Francisco, and you've got 80 billion of these and 1,000 trillion connections. The part that's always been interesting to me is this issue that essentially all of the operations of the brain are happening under the hood at a level that you don't have any access to or acquaintance with. So all the things that we really care about, like, you know, love and joy and the agony and the ecstasy and all this stuff, we don't even know how that's happening. So, at this level, when I pick up a glass of water and I bring it to my mouth, I don't know how I'm doing it. That's actually underpinned by a lightning storm of brain activity. But all I know as a conscious being is whether I've spilled it on myself or not. And I don't really know how the operations are happening. And it's like that with everything, recognizing a friend's face or getting a joke or falling in love or driving a car. All these things are happening at this level. And that's always been very interesting to me, this concept about the unconscious brain. Essentially, the conscious part of you, which is the part that flickers to life when you wake up in the morning, that's the smallest bit of what's happening in your brain. That's the broom closet in the mansion of your brain. So think about when you have an idea and you say, oh, I just thought of something. It wasn't actually you that thought of it. Your brain's been working on that behind the scenes for hours or days, consolidating information, putting things together, trying things out, evaluating things. And at some point, it serves it up to your consciousness. And you say, oh, I'm a genius. But it wasn't really you. And so that's the issue. So as Carl Jung said, in each of us, there is another whom we do not know. Or as Pink Floyd put it, there's someone in my head, but it's not me. So let me just give an example of this. This was a study done many years ago where men were shown photographs of women's faces, and they were just asked to judge how attractive they thought the woman was on a scale from 1 to 10. And what the men didn't know is that in half of the photos, the women's eyes had been dilated with some eye drops. And so what happened is that uniformly the men decided that they judged that the women with the dilated eyes were more attractive. But the key thing is that none of the men noticed this consciously and said, oh, I see that her eyes are a millimeter larger than her eyes over here. Nobody was able to report that. And presumably none of the men knew that dilated eyes in women is a biological sign of sexual readiness. But their brains knew it, whoomp, and here they were making the right sorts of choices as defined by evolutionary pressures without having any access as to why they were doing that. And of course, love always goes this way. You find yourself more attracted to some people than others. You don't know why. But the why is lots of stuff happening under the hood. So there's this enormous gap between what your conscious mind has access to and what your brain is doing. So one way you can think about this is like, you know, like if you were the CEO of an enormous company like United Airlines, you know, you've got so many people in the company that you can't possibly be in everybody's cubicle and doing their software updates and seeing where the food's coming from and so on. Instead, the CEO just kicks his or her feet up on the desk and waits for the phone to ring if something goes wrong. And that's what the conscious mind is like. It essentially is trusting the operations that are happening underneath. So let me give you an example. So everyone grab two dry erase markers in front of you. Go ahead and hold your two dry erase markers. Okay, pretend you're in front of a dry erase board. I want you to sign your name forwards and backwards. So do your signature forwards and backwards at the same time. Like a mirror image. Okay, some of you did better than others on that. Here's the key. Try this next time you're in front of a dry erase board, because the whole thing has to do with leaving the conscious mind out, because as soon as the conscious mind is participating in that, you're dead. You can't do it anymore. This is something that the unconscious mind can take care of very easily, but as soon as you start thinking about what do backwards letters look like and so on, you get caught in this, in these stuttering strokes, and you can't do it. So consciousness takes all the credit at once, but really it's best left at the sidelines for so many things. And there's so many things that we know how to do that you don't have any conscious access to at all. So I'd like everyone to put your hands on your steering wheel. So go ahead and put your hands on your steering wheel. You're in the middle lane. I want you to make a lane change into your right, into the right lane. So go from the center lane to the right lane as you're driving, 30 miles an hour. Okay. Okay, I saw one guy use his blinker. That was very good. Okay, but here's the key. It's hard to see everyone at once, but the thing that I saw was that people make a turn to the right and then back to center. Is that what you did? Yeah. Okay, that would steer you off the road, and you've just crashed into buildings. The way that you make a lane change is you turn to the right, back to center, just as far to the left, and back to center again. That's what a lane change looks like, and you do it every day, and you have no idea how you're doing it. So this is the sense in which the unconscious brain is just taking care of most of the stuff that's going on. One of the advantages of coming to the talk this morning is that you'll always know how to win a tennis game from now on. All you need to do is compliment your opponent on his serve and say, "You serve so well. How exactly do you do that?" And as soon as they start trying to explain it, they're dead. They can't do it anymore. And if any of you play, you know, a musical instrument or something, you know, as soon as you start paying attention to your fingers, you can't do it anymore. When I was younger, I used to play baseball, and our coach would say, "I want you guys to think out there." And I'd say, "Actually, you don't want us to think out there. You want us to train a sufficient number of hours that we automatize these behaviors, and then we go out there and perform." But he never believed me, so I had to write books on it eventually. Okay, so what's the point of this? The point is that almost all of your cognition is happening under the hood. It's happening incognito. So that's sort of the first bit of this, is that a lot of how we're learning and so on is happening under the hood. The second part that I just want to address, because I was asked to talk about this, about creativity, is given that so much is happening under the hood, how do we move beyond automatized behavior? Because this is part of what's really special about humans, is that we actually have ways of being quite creative. And so, you know, no matter for everybody here, no matter what your business situation is or academic situation or whatever, we need to have this cognitive flexibility where we're not simply running as automatons. So the question is, how do you steer your unconscious brain to be more flexible? So to answer this, let's start with this very simple exercise. Just for a moment, imagine yourself standing on a beach at sunset. Okay, so how many of you included some coconut husks on the beach? By raise of hand. Okay, one person. How many people included some birds in the sky? Okay. How many people included some swimmers in the water? Okay, how about the white foam tips of the wave? Okay. Pretty impoverished, right? Almost nobody raised their hand for any of these things. And the question is, why is it so impoverished? So let me explain something very quickly about how the brain works, which many of you probably know. The brain is composed of neurons, which send these chemical and electrical signals all around the place. The key thing is that everything is connected to everything else. And so what's actually happening in the brain, the way to think about it is it's an associative network. So when I walk down the hall and I smell the coffee, I think about what coffee is going to feel like on my fingertips and how it's going to taste on my tongue and the name of my barista at Starbucks and how coffee is going to make me feel alert and so on. All these things are linked in a giant net of associations. That's what the brain is like. And if we zoom in, if I think, for example, of a rabbit, that's associated in these networks with everything that I know about rabbits. So that's how the brain is working. And the question is, why, therefore, when I asked you to think about the beach, why did you come up with the simplest thing? Like, what happened to the rest of that network? And this is the problem of the path of least resistance, which is that the unconscious brain is ruthlessly efficient, which has been very useful because in evolutionary timescales, when you were hungry, you went out and you found food. You didn't go dance or paint or something like that. You solved the problem. And so this is part of why the brain is so ruthlessly efficient in finding the shortest path through these issues. But the good news is we have brain plasticity. And this is actually the topic of my next book called Live Wired. The issue is that you can't really think of the brain as hardware or software. It's this other thing. It's liveware that is constantly reconfiguring itself. So there have been lots of studies on this. I'll just mention a couple. So, you know, in one study, people are taught how to juggle, and after they get good at it and they can do it for 60 seconds, the investigators do fMRI, and what they find is that this is MRI. You can see physical changes in the structure of their brain just based on their learning how to juggle. In other words, this goes against the traditional view of the brain that it's sort of fixed in place. You can, with the naked eye, see physical changes that are happening when people learn something new at the structural level. Same thing if you pick up a new instrument and start learning how to play that. You know, there are physical changes in the structure of your brain that are visible with the naked eye. And at autopsy, actually, you can tell the difference between, for example, a violin player and a piano player because of the way that influences their brain, their motor cortex in particular. So what you do changes the structure of your brain. So this is why this issue of plasticity is important, because when you think about these networks, the issue is that when you ask your brain for something, it's going to always give you the first, simplest answer first. It's going to give you the path of least resistance. And what you need to do is go back and dig deeper and ask it again and ask it again. And this is actually not a new idea at all. Leonardo da Vinci had insight into this. He was famous for questioning everything in the outside world, but also for questioning everything on the inside world. And his strategy was, whatever the first answer is, throw that out and keep asking again and again to dig deeper. And so the job is to push on the unconscious brain to get better answers. So how do you implement this? Well, one way is with idea quotas. This is what Thomas Edison does. This is what I do with all my students, whenever I'm asking them to solve some sort of problem, instead of coming back with one solution, I say, I want you to come back with 7 solutions tomorrow. And so it forces them to dig deeper and think of things that they didn't do. So instead of following the first answer, the path of least resistance, they dig a little deeper. I'll just mention a couple other things about brain plasticity and creativity. Environment actually matters. So there were studies years ago where they took normal rats and they put a rat into an isolated cage, and then they measured the neurons in the brain, and they found that in the normal situation, the neurons looked a particular way, but with the isolated rat, the neurons were shrunken. There weren't as many connections. They then took a third cage, let's say the party cage, and they put all the rats in there, and they had the balls and the wheels and so on, and they measured their neurons, and they were massively arborized and making connections all over. And so environment actually matters, and I think this is important, you know, having this thing versus this thing. It makes a difference. You know, it's not just what's on the inside, but what's around you too. The other thing is cultivating risk tolerance and allowing mistakes in our businesses and our lives, things like this. It takes a lot of trial and error to find things, and it's really important to be able to do that. I'm just surfing over the top of several deep points, but the last thing I'll say is that for plasticity to happen in the brain, you require certain neurotransmitters to be present, and those are correlated with emotional engagement. That's what allows these changes to happen. So the question for us all to be asking in our work, in our lives, and in our, labs, whatever we're doing, is what are we doing to engage and inspire ourselves and others? And I think the reason this matters is because of where we're going. We're no longer a manufacturing economy. We're an information economy. But I don't think this is going to be where it stays. As computers get better and better at digesting huge amounts of information, where we're moving is towards a creativity economy, I think, where the idea is that we'll be, we'll have more freedom as computers take care of this stuff, and we'll be able to really be concentrating on how to be creative. So that was the first two parts about how the brain learns and how we can steer ourselves to be more creative. I just surfed over the top of some high-level things. What I want to do now is just use that as the lens to talk about the this project that I've been working on for a little while here, which is which has to do with how technology is going to change the way that we're taking in information and how that's going to expand the experience of being a human. So many of you are probably aware that there are hundreds of thousands of people walking around with artificial hearing and artificial vision. So the way a cochlear implant works is you take a digital microphone and you slip an electrode strip into the inner ear, and people can come to hear this way. Or with a retinal implant, you take a camera, you digitize the signal, you put it into an electrode grid that plugs into the retina. And the key thing about this is that 20 years ago, nobody thought this was going to work. And the question is, why? Well, it's because these devices speak the language of Silicon Valley, and it's not really the same language as your natural biological sense organs. And so that's why people thought this was never going to work. But it worked. And so the question is, how? How are people seeing and hearing with this? Well, the whole secret comes down to this, which is that your brain is not seeing or hearing any of this, me or my sound or any of this. All that's happening, everything that's happening is in here, in the silence and darkness of your brain. All that you're actually experiencing is these electrochemical signals moving around in these incredibly huge, vast networks, and that's how you construct your world around you. Now, what's kind of amazing is that the brain is really good at taking in these signals and extracting patterns and assigning meaning to them. And that's how you get your entire subjective world around you. But the key is this. The key point is that your brain doesn't know and it doesn't care where the data come from. All it knows is I've got data in here, and it figures out what it can do with that. So let me phrase this as a hypothesis for now, but I'll give you a very quick version of how, why I believe this is true, that the brain is essentially a general purpose computing device, where whatever the peripheral sensors that you stick in, it just figures out what it's going to do with it, and how to deal with those input channels. And so I call this the pH model of evolution, where pH stands for potato head. And the idea is that all these sensors that we know and love, like our eyes and our nose and our ears and our fingertips and our mouth, these are all just plug-and-play peripheral devices. You stick them in, and you're good to go. And the brain just figures out what to do with the data that comes in. And part of the reason I believe this is because when you look across the animal kingdom, you find lots of different peripheral devices. So you find heat pits in snakes, you find electroreceptors in these knife fish, you find star nose, which is like 22 fingers on this nose that feels around. Lots of insects and birds and cows have magnetite, so they can orient to the magnetic field of the earth. There's lots of peripheral devices that you can plug in, and what this suggests is that once Mother Nature figures out the principles of brain operation, she can plug in whatever she wants. She doesn't have to worry about designing new peripherals. Let me put it this way. She only has to worry about designing new peripherals, and then she can just stick them in, and the brain will figure out what to do with that. And so the lesson that surfaces here, if this is correct, is that there's nothing really special or fundamental about the sensors that we happen to come to the table with. It's just what we've inherited from a complex road of evolution. But it's not what we have to stick with. And I think the best evidence of that comes from what's called sensory substitution. And that refers to feeding information into the brain via an unusual sensory channel, and the brain just figures out what to do with it. Now, this might sound speculative, but the first paper demonstrating this was published in the journal Nature in 1969. There was a scientist named Paul Bakke-Rida, and he put blind people into a modified dental chair. And he set up a video camera and would put something in front of the camera. And whatever was in front of the camera, you would feel that in your back via this grid of solenoids. You would feel it pressed in your back. So he puts a face or a shape or a coffee cup, whatever, in front of the camera. And you're feeling that in your back. And blind people got really good at being able to tell what was there, even though the information was coming in here. It was a somatosensory thing. Now, there have been a lot of modern incarnations of this. These are the with these sonic glasses. It takes a video feed of what's right in front of you. This is for blind people, and turns it into an audio landscape. So as you're walking around, you're feeling, you're hearing this. First, it sounds like a cacophony, but blind people get really good at being able to navigate the world this way. It doesn't have to be through the ears. This version has it as an electro-tactile grid on the forehead. Why the forehead? Because you're not using it for anything else. And so they can get pretty good at this. The most modern incarnation is called the brain port, where you stick it on the tongue. And it's a little electro-tactile grid. It feels like pop rocks. And whatever the camera is seeing, you're feeling that on your tongue. And blind people get so good at this, they can do things like throw a ball into a basket or navigate a complex obstacle course by this information on their tongue. Now, if it sounds completely crazy to think about seeing through your tongue, just remember that that's all vision ever is. All vision ever is electrochemical signals getting to your brain, and the route by which they get there doesn't really matter. Okay, so in my lab, one of the things that's been of great interest is figuring out how we can do sensory substitution for the deaf. And this is a project that I've done with a former grad student of mine, Scott Novick. And here's what we wanted to accomplish was a person says something, we have some sort of device that translates that such that a deaf person can completely get what is being said in the world. And so we wanted to make this something that could be used on a phone and something that would be a wearable. So here's the concept. So as I'm speaking, the phone is picking up on the sound of my voice. And the phone is actually transmitting Bluetooth, and so what's happening is I'm feeling the sonic world around me. It's being translated into patterns of vibration on the vest. So deaf people who are completely deaf, can learn the language of the vest this way and can pick up on what's going on, because this is actually exactly what your inner ear is doing. Your inner ear takes frequencies. It takes the sound wave, busts it up into frequencies, and sends it to the brain. This is the same thing. It's now you have the sound on your torso. Why the torso? Because you're not really using it for anything else. So we've been testing this with deaf people for a while now. Here's an older video. Here we go. Let's see if this works. So this is Scott. He says a word.
You.
Yeah. So he says the word you. Jonathan is completely deaf. He feels that on the vest. And this is his fifth day here.
Where?
He's able to translate the complicated pattern of vibrations into an understanding of what's being said.
Touch.
Now, the pattern is too complicated. He doesn't know, he can't tell you exactly how it's going, because these are in 20 millisecond frames that the pattern is changing. But you can see, just as an example, here's a subject wearing the vest, and here she's saying sound, and here she's saying touch. And if you look very closely, you can even see visually the difference in the patterns, and you can kind of get an understanding of how people learn up on this. And one of the great advantages, I think, about this whole endeavor is that the only solution for people who are deaf is a cochlear implant, and that's about $100,000 when you have the doctor's visits plus the invasive surgery plus the equipment. And we can make the vest for less than $1,000, and I think that's going to be able to change the landscape of people getting access to this kind of technology, because there are 53 million deaf people. The last thing I want to say very quickly is that beyond deafness, there are lots of things that we're experimenting with the vest, because this is actually a really useful way to feed in any kind of information stream. So can we feed things indirectly from the internet? Just as one example, here's a subject feeling data input. He doesn't know what the data is, but he gets two buttons that appear on the screen here, a yellow and a blue button, and he makes a choice, and then a second and a half later, he gets feedback, either a frowny face or a smiley face. What the subject doesn't know is that what we're actually feeding in is real-time data from the stock market, and he's making buy and sell decisions. And what we're seeing is, can he develop a pattern, an understanding of the very large-scale pattern going on to be able to make better decisions? We've tried things we've tried things with Twitter, taking millions of tweets and doing natural language processing and feeding that into the vest. We're doing things with being able to, instead of having a smell dog, if you can feel with a molecular detector all kinds of new scents and have that presented to you. We're doing things with prosthetics, so we're putting angle and pressure sensors into a leg so that somebody with a prosthetic leg can actually feel where their leg is. They can get that information and have that restored. We're doing things with virtual reality. So here, this is a shooting game, and the subject gets to feel what's going on as she's getting shot from various angles. We're doing this with drone pilots, where we're translating the pitch, yaw, roll, orientation, and heading into what's being felt on the vest. So it's essentially like you're feeling the vest, you're feeling your skin up on the drone, and this allows pilots to be able to pilot in the dark or at large distances away. And where this is heading is just this general issue that it's really hard to be able to take in multidimensional information visually. Our brains are not meant, our visual systems are very good at certain things, but not taking in high-dimensional information. Your body, though, is quite good at this, which is why, for example, you can balance on one foot, because you're taking in lots of information, and that goes up to the brain, and it's used to that kind of high-dimensional stuff. So I think there's really no end of the possibilities on the horizon. Astronauts being able to feel the overall health of the International Space Station, or you feeling the invisible signals of your own body's health, like blood sugar and state of your microbiome, or having 360-degree vision, or seeing in infrared or ultraviolet. These are all things that we're working on. So the last thing I'll say is that as we move into the future, we're going to be able to increasingly choose the kind of peripheral devices that we want, because what Mother Nature has given us are these sensory gifts on her timescales, but we don't need to wait on her timescales anymore, because what she's also given us is the cognitive capacity to be able to go out and define our own trajectory. So the question is, how do you want to experience your universe? So thanks very much.
Thank you. Always inspiring, David Eagleman. The next speaker, it's a real pleasure for me to introduce. Jyoti Mishra is an assistant professor at UCSF. We've worked together for almost a decade. She's faculty in our new center, Neuroscape. And we're going to take even a deeper dive into some science now, so I hope you enjoy. Help welcome Jyoti to the stage. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam. All right, I'm just waiting for my slides to get pulled up here. Awesome, thank you. David, a very prolific speaker, but I'll present some more deeper dive into creativity, what we know about it from the scientific literature that's been looking at basically brain mechanisms of creativity, what we know about it, and how do we enhance it. And let's see, so when you look in the literature for the definition, this is how people refer to it, is the ability to generate ideas, solutions, or insights that are novel, which we all know about, but also that are feasible. So that's an important aspect, that it should be feasible to do. And David talked a lot about aspects of creativity that are incognito, the unconscious, but actually in the literature, when we look at the theory, there's actually a dual pathway model for how creativity comes about. One aspect of that is cognitive flexibility, which is the idea that you can move from, when you're presented with multiple goals, you can switch from one to the other really rapidly, and that you can, perform accurately and optimally at whatever the goal of that point in time is, and not be distracted by the other goal, essentially. And so that's cognitive flexibility. Being able to switch between tasks, but at the same time, what's important for creativity is the idea of cognitive persistence. So the idea that once you're in a state where you know what's going on, that you can actually exploit that state and be really, you know, optimally performing in that state. So at the intersection of that is really where theoretically creativity is known to lie, which is really interesting, though not a lot of experiments yet have shown you know, the basis for this, but this is what is theoretically hypothesized for generation of creativity. Now, the idea for this is that it's the model itself, it really depends on what needs to be completed. You could be in an environment that obviously may require more exploration, which is related to cognitive flexibility, or it might be a model that requires more exploitation. When you go to a new country, new surroundings, you're more in exploration mode. When you're at your work desk, possibly for that day, you're in exploitation mode. And so it really depends on the task that has to be completed. What it also really depends on is individual functioning, and depends on the kind of person you might be. And do you, as a trait, are you more of an exploiter or a person who is more of a explorer? And we all know, in some senses, you know, what we are in general. Like, do we like to be in new surroundings, and are we first adopters of technology, or are we people who like to see what everybody's doing with it? How, you know, I'm gonna be taking on the iPhone 6, not the first iPhone, and so on. So, so really, it really depends on the task and also the trait. Now, this concept of individual functioning is really interesting because it leads to the idea of team creativity and productivity. So this is the idea of the group creativity, and that genius is really not alone. So for example, we all know Einstein's contribution to science, famous contribution to science, was on general relativity, but what we don't know is that there were many other scientists who really did contribute to essentially relativity coming about. So it was not just the guy in the middle, but also other people at the time who brought this into place. And this is actually illustrated by this cartoon, which is, you know, standing on the shoulders of giants, where Einstein here is being held up by, you know, Newton. You can see very clearly up there with the apple on his head, and of course Maxwell and Gauss and Riemann, and then other scientists who all helped to bring about the idea of general relativity. And Einstein was really about generalizing the principle of relativity in the field. And the idea of group creativity also applies to the discovery of electricity by Nikola Tesla, and also the discovery of the light bulb, where Edison had a huge team of people who'd constantly make inventions, and then he'd go on to see, you know, what would really be a feasible novel invention to take on, and it turned out the electric light bulb was one of them. And so, so that's the concept of group creativity. So essentially working with people in teams that are, some of you may have traits that are more exploratory in nature, and others may have traits that are more exploitative in nature, and then bringing those teams together can really build up the creative content of the teams that is putting together a new product or a new invention. And in modern times, that is also true for the smartphones that we have, for the iPhone and the Galaxy phone. And there's a famous lawsuit between the two companies about who owns the patents. It turned out it was very much shared creativity in terms of the discovery of the tech that went behind these smartphone devices. And so from this, I kind of switched to the idea of creativity in some ways is related to intellectual ability. It is somewhat predictable. So here is Julia Stanley, who did a study of precocious youth in the 70s and followed them for about 20 years or so. And so he is looking at adolescents and who are taking their SATs, and then kind of really looking at the cream of the crop, looking at the top 1% of the people who, of the adolescents performing on the SATs. And then even in the top 1%, when you can divide them up into quartiles, and so that's what they are up there. In the quartiles, you can see the people who are in the top, very much top quartile, Q4, are the ones who are also, if you were to take, you know, real life metrics of creativity in science, you're taking like whether they got doctorates or publications or patents or income percentiles and so on, they're still performing more, so at a higher rate. So essentially saying that, you know, your real life metrics of creativity map onto what you can do in adolescence. So there's a high intellectual component to this. And this is another curve, which also in the literature, when you look at measures of quantifying creativity, it tends to peak during the adolescence period. And these are, so measures of creativity are, you can do them verbally and also visually. So how people really measure creativity in the lab is really, it's very simple tests. So for example, in the visual domain, which what you're given for a creativity test is essentially objects. So you'll see that you'll get circles or like these little objects up here. And then you're just asked, just combine them in ways that, you know, they're, that are creative or novel. And so the solutions that you'll see up there in the middle column are essentially more creative solutions than the ones that are there in the last column. And that's how they're graded in terms of the creative content, the originality of the outcome. And essentially, these are the tests that one uses in the visual spatial domain. And then in the verbal domain, you're just asked, can you think about alternate uses of certain items that are presented to you? And even though David talked a lot about you know, subconscious processing, if you really think about, if you really investigate what's happening in the creative brain when, you know, tasks such as the divergent thinking tasks are, people are doing those kinds of tasks, what are the areas that are involved? Well, they're very much the usual culprits that are involved in cognitive processing, not subconscious processing. So for example, when we think about verbal divergent thinking, the regions of the brain that are very much active are regions that are involved in language. And then when you think about visual divergent thinking, the parts of the brain that are involved are up here, which is the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which is very much an executive functioning center involved in working memory, attention, cognitive flexibility, and so on. So very much the same parts of the brain that give you that cognitive muscle are the parts of the brain that are involved in creativity. At the same time, though, we don't know that much about the brain mechanisms of how does your brain really bring about creativity. Yes, there's the dual model about cognitive flexibility. If you have high cognitive flexibility and possibly persistence, then like you put this magic potion together and then you, voila, like creativity comes about. But how does it really come together? We don't know that yet, and that's what neuroscience will contribute over the next decade or and more. Okay, so the good news at the end really is that creativity is plastic, and like David showed, there are multiple ways that the brain can learn and enhance functioning. And in the lab that we are here at UCSF, that's directed by Adam Ghazali at Neuroscape, we're actually developing a lot of tools and video games that enhance cognitive functioning. And at the same time, currently we haven't really looked at how that might influence creative functioning, but that is something that we're gonna do in new studies. But the evidence that's currently out there for creativity being plastic is the following. So in the first slide over here, what I'm showing is that this is actually a study that came out of Stanford, and I think the next presenter, Manish, Dr. Sagar, he's gonna talk about this work, so I'm not going to elaborate on it too much, because Stanford has this great program called a creative capacity building program, and essentially what they do in there is not that much of a mystery. But if you take the theory of creativity, if you take people in teams and you put them through tasks where they have to come up with novel solutions, novel and feasible solutions to the task, and then you move on to other tasks and so on and so forth, then you practice that for many weeks in a row, and that's your creativity capacity building program. And of course, Dr. Sauer is going to tell you more about that, but essentially what you look at is these measures of creativity, these objective measures of creativity in the lab, and what you see is that prior to that program versus after that program, you get a boost in creative performance, and relative to a control, which is a language capacity building program. So that's at one end, where you could literally put yourself into a program that develops the definition of creativity. And on the other hand, there's some interesting evidence that's coming about where there's another study we're looking at integrated mind-body training, which in this case was essentially like mindfulness training. And mindfulness training, in this case, relative to relaxation training, was shown to enhance creativity as well. And that's also a very interesting aspect, because here what we see is that on the left, the program, what that develops on the left is a program that's more about cognitive flexibility, whereas the program on the right is more about cognitive persistence, staying with your breath, staying with the emotions that your body's feeling, and so on. But interestingly, both of these programs tend to enhance creativity as such. And last thing I mentioned on this is that when you think about mindfulness, the program on the right, one of the, in terms of the brain mechanisms of mindfulness, one of the things that has been observed very consistently is the role of frontal alpha oscillation. So alpha is a neural rhythm that happens at a 10 hertz frequency, and meditators tend to have a really much higher alpha rhythm. And alpha can be increased through meditation, through neurofeedback. And more recently, there was a study in 2015 where they talked about increasing alpha through neurostimulation. And in that study, it was like a one-time, one-session neurostimulation study of alpha, and that showed an increase in creativity. It was a controlled study and so on. So if you want that magic dose, it's like neurostimulation in the alpha range is the one, might be the one for you. But this is what is out there, and I'm sure we'll be doing a lot of cool stuff with tech that tends to enhance either cognitive flexibility or persistence, or the combination of both, and I'm sure I'll be able to share more of that with you in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you to GOT. So we're going to combine now. We're going to have two speakers for one, Manish Sagar and Grace Hawthorne, who are both professors at Stanford, and we're going to take a nice deep dive into creativity with them. So give a big round of applause and invite them to the stage. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam. Pleasure. Thank you. Okay, so I'll probably stand here.
Hi, you guys. How's it going? We're going to
try
to
check 1, 2, 3. Works.
Advance the slide. So today, Manish and I are going to be talking about creative capacity building in the brain, and we are going to kick things off by going analog.
Yeah.
So underneath your chair, everybody, find a black piece of construction paper. Can we get the first slide up, possibly?
Probably wondering throughout what this is for. Yes, it's for an exercise.
While we get the slides up. Okay, so as soon as you have it in your hand, hold it up. Okay? So I am going to give you a task. You're going to complete it in 30 seconds. Okay? When you're done with the task, I want you to hold it up again. Okay? So this is your objective with this piece of paper. In the next 30 seconds, only using your hands, you are going to transform this piece of paper. what this paper is going to do when you're done is it's going to cover your face, but it's still going to allow you to see, and it'll be hands-free. Three objectives. Does anybody have any questions? Okay? You're going to create, you're going to transform this paper into something that'll cover your face, but it'll still allow you to see, and that you don't have to hold up with your hands. Okay? Ready? Go.
Wow, you're on the summary already.
Okay, wait. Can we back up to the first slide, please?
We're done.
Back. Okay, you guys have 15 seconds left.
That's cool. Like it.
10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hands down. Hold it up. Everyone hold it up. You're not wearing it. You're just holding it. Okay? I gotta get my camera ready because I'm gonna take a picture because you guys are gonna pass it to your right. And now put it on.
Or left.
Or left. Pass it to the person next to you or switch with somebody. Okay? And now wear it. Okay? Okay, everyone have it on? I can't really see you guys, so. Okay, so I see some successes. Okay, that's good. It's resting your head. Okay, that's awesome. Okay, so I'm Grace. This is Manish.
Hi.
We have been working on a project for the last 5 years at Stanford. What you just did was a warm-up that I run in one of my classes that I teach at Stanford called Creative Gym. In that 30 seconds, you had a little kind of quick dive into materiality, rapid prototyping, empathy. The mask was not for you. You had paper. You had the constraint of only your hands, right? And you had to start immediately because you only had 30 seconds to do it. The class I teach that this is from is called Creative Gym. I teach it at the D School. I've been there for 8 years. What the D School teaches, or kind of what they want people to do, is unlock everyone's creative potential. And they do this through this methodology called design thinking, which is a process for innovation. But just because you know how to do something doesn't necessarily mean you're going to do it well. So if we as humans are going to solve the world's messy problems, we have to be really in tune, if not just how are we going to solve it, but the nuances about it. So a lot of the things that we heard this morning related to the unconscious mind, about intuition, all relate to what we're trying to teach. So this is the analogy that we usually talk about when you describe kind of the skill sets that we're trying to share or train people in this course, which is if we had a banana bread recipe, one pot wonder, 2 cups of flour, 1 cup of sugar, and we all had it. We all know exactly what goes in it. It tells you exactly what to do. But we all took this recipe, went back to our respective kitchens, and cooked this bread. Do you think when we came back and did a bread tasting, if all our bread would taste the same? No, but why not? We had the same exact ingredient. We had the same instructions. And it's because of the nuances. It's maybe how I mashed my bananas, how you stirred all your ingredients. Maybe Manish nuked his butter because he just couldn't wait to get it to room temperature.
Yep.
Right?
Pretty much.
So it's these little things that make somebody a better design thinker than another. So if you're in my class, you would do basically Iron Chef exercises with office supplies, very much like the 30-second exercise we just did. And basically, at the end of the course, you are going to come away with a honed design intuition. You'll have a higher bias to action. You will not have a fear to failure. And you'll generally feel really dang good about yourself, okay? So in the 10-week course, these are like the 9 headlines of each session. So you kind of get a sense. They're all related to humanness, right? Seeing, feeling, starting, communicating, building, inspiring, synthesizing, connecting, navigating. So the story really begins, that was just kind of the preface, is with Daniel Hong. 5 years ago, Daniel Hong, who is a neuroscientist, he's a brain surgeon. He comes up to me after my class, he says, Grace, God, I feel really good. I feel different. Am I different? I'm like, yeah, you're different. You just kind of did this. This is really great. You have exercised all these, you know, parts of your brain you never did before. Now you have this toolbox of all these skills you can apply in your life. And he's like, no, but am I different? Like, is my brain different? I go, you're the brain surgeon. Like, you tell me. And that kind of literally was the beginning of the path to this incredible longitudinal study we've been doing for the past 5 years. And there's two questions that we ask. One, can you teach creativity? Yes, the answer is yes. And two, is creativity acquired knowledge, like riding a bike? Once you know how to ride a bike, you forever know how to ride a bike. Or is it a muscle in your brain that you have to exercise, very much like the core of your body? The answer is yes. Like sit-ups, right? Regardless if you're a professional football player or you're just a speed walker, a rec tennis player, or even just to like have good posture, you need a strong core. Your creativity is the core of your brain, and you need to exercise it to kind of maintain good posture regardless of your discipline. Whether you're a brain surgeon, a stay-at-home mom, a plumber, an educator, it doesn't matter. So with that, I'm going to hand over the reins to Manish, and he will dive deep. He is the science.
Okay.
Tis and the science.
Thanks so much, Grace. Before I dive into the science and blah, blah, let me just take a moment to give you one warning. I'm high on painkillers right now. I had a back injury last night playing with my two-year-old. Shouldn't do that before a talk. But I want to take a moment to thank Grace and people from Design School, because how many schools do you know in the whole world which actually focus on teaching these life skills? They're not only skills that you become a better engineer and blah, blah, but you actually become a great person and a creative and innovative person. So big thanks, I think, to Grace and D-School. And with that, when Grace came with her students to our lab, at that time I was a postdoc in Alan Reese's lab in the Department of Psychiatry. The question was, as she put very nicely, is can, first of all, given that they have been doing it and they know that they are enhancing creativity, is there a scientific way to back up the claim? And also, what changes in the brain? So we started with this really long, 5-year-long study. I don't think I have a pointer, but it was what we called a longitudinal crossover design. So we have randomly assigned 36 people into two groups. One gets the creativity training. The other group gets actually a control training, because we want to control for everything else but the creativity instruction, right? So they do come to D school in a separate room. They have a very motivational instructor which teaches them how to draw Mandarin characters and how to speak in Chinese. So basically, you think about this. In Creative Gym, she's teaching rapid prototyping, improvisation, and how to build upon your creative process. In the other course, the other teacher, Ning, in this case, is teaching how to follow instruction as closely as possible, because we wanted to see whether the effect of training is actually there, or is it just that people come to D school and boom, that's it. And so that was the first part, and then we assess these people before, after 5 weeks, there's 10 hours of training, and then there's a crossover when the group who got the Creative Gym now gets the Language Gym, because we want to also see whether the improvements that Grace and her awesome course did actually stay, or do they come down, or is it a muscle, which actually turns out to be the case. And then we did a 1-year follow-up where we wanted to see, okay, 1 year down the road, what happens? And then we did a funny thing called booster shot to see if you give a quick training, whether that enhances creativity. Unfortunately, won't have time to go into all pieces of it, so I'll only talk about the first two pieces, that is the time one and the effect of taking the course and how that changed the brain. This is a huge list of different things we tried to, assess participants on to see. Just like Jyoti mentioned earlier, that we wanted to see whether intelligence has anything to do with it, whether personality has anything to do with it, whether which area you're working in has anything to do with it, and what does that somehow put you in a different level and then you enhance your creativity in a different way. That's something we call predictors and covariates. And then we wanted to see what changes in the behavior. So the first thing you want to know is, okay, if the claim is it's a creative gym, then does actually creativity changes? And there are some standardized ways which are not perfect, but they exist, like the Torrance test of creative thinking, which I briefly delved into in a minute, is one way to look at it. So we did that assessment at 3 different time points. We also looked at information processing or executive functioning. And the reason was because most of the exercises were building a bias towards action, that you do rapid prototyping just like you did, think less, do more kind of thing. If that is indeed the case, we should see changes in cognitive flexibility. We should see changes in information processing specifically, that basically you act fast. And the side of the third aspect was measuring changes in the brain. So there we basically assessed people on all possible ways. So we looked at their structural changes in the brain, we looked at functional changes in the brain, resting state connectivity and DTI, the structural connectivity changes in the brain, wiring. So today I'll only focus, given the time I have, not 30 seconds I hope, the timing shows. But
what you guys have to understand is the subjects who participated in our study pre and post training and then in the crossover, everybody went through an fMRI scanner and a battery of neuropsych tests on three separate occasions, which is a huge time investment part.
Absolutely. Okay, so let me just quickly take you through some of the things. First, how do we assess creativity? That's a, probably a bigger, biggest question. What do we actually mean by creativity? Maybe it's even bigger. So to us, to science in general, there's been huge debate about how do you define creativity. But one thing pretty much everybody settles on is you make something new or novel in some respect, but also it has to be appropriate or useful. So just because I dance here in a novel way, if it's kind of not useful, it's not creative. It has to have some kind of appropriateness. So one way that people have been testing creativity since 1960s is something called Thorin's test of creative thinking. And the idea here is you give people incomplete drawings, and you give them about 10 minutes, and let them just complete the drawing, with a caveat that you say you have to come up with a very unusual and very unique story. That's all you tell them. And just to give you a couple of examples, and then we later assess these on different things. So here's an example of something that we measure called resistance to closure. And the idea there is, if I give you this left on the left side, I give you this triangle, incomplete triangle, and I tell you you have 10 minutes, if you give this to me, I'll probably fill in the triangle, fill it up, and be very happy about it, because I filled the triangle. But that's kind of, I gave up into this urge to just come up with the most obvious first solution, like David mentioned, the first answer if you give them the least resistance path kind of thing. But some people just never actually go there. Just they end up doing things where they don't, just they basically try to stay away from the obvious answer. And here is an example of that. And that's kind of things we measure. They sound abstract, but the idea is to somehow use these to come up with one composite measure of creativity. This is one of them. The other example, which I love, is this one. If you give somebody that drawing on the left, and they come up with this. Now, this person literally went outside the box. You know, there's a box, and he's like, well, over there, or she. And so that's originality or non-conformity. And then there is something called elaboration, the details that the mustache has, and stuff like that. So these are the five different things, so flexibility, fluency, how many ideas they had, originality, elaboration, and this resistance to closure, how much do you avoid that? So you combine them all up, and that's what Thorin's test does, and you come up with a score. And you can assess people on these scores individually or a combined score, whichever you like. So that's it, and then the second thing that we'll talk about today is the second test of executive functioning, which is very commonly known in the literature. That's Stroop test, where you give people these colors. You just name the color in one condition, or you just read the word. The first two conditions are very simple, obvious, unambiguous, straightforward things. The second two have a twist in them. For example, the third one, you have the color, you have to name the ink, but not the color. Or read the word, but not the color. So red is written in green color. So I will say, don't say the what is written in, but name the color itself. So that's inhibition. You have to inhibit responses. The last one is we just complicate it more and say, if you have a box around it, you do the one thing. If it doesn't have a box, you do the other thing. So these other things measure more cognitive flexibility things. Now coming to the results. So the first result, I think Jyoti kind of mentioned it already, is from our paper where we found that we just with 5 weeks of training, it's published in 2014, with 10 hours of training roughly, we were able to enhance certain aspects of creativity, especially this resistance to closure, this urge to not do the obvious answer. And the second thing, as compared to the language, Jim, and a second thing, the information processing aspect, we found that although these are people in and around Stanford with really high IQs, we were still able to enhance their basic information processing skills using Grace's course. So in the dotted line is the CCBP, the creative gym people, the solid line is the language people, and the enhanced. So the idea, what I'm trying to say is we did not change necessarily the more complicated executive functioning pieces like inhibition and stuff because they were already pretty high to start with. But this basic information processing skills, the bias towards action that Grace just mentioned, I think we were able to do it and we were able to measure it as well. That you give them a problem, give you 30 seconds to do something, they were much faster to react and actually do it. And we were able to quantify that. That is indeed the case. So these are the behavioral results, which have a huge, at least a huge literature to back them up in a way. But how do you imagine assessing the brain correlates of creativity when somebody is lying down in this big beast? I don't know if you've been to this. It's like a big thing which sounds really, really loud, and you go in this tunnel. It's not really a near death experience, but it's actually a huge thing. And you lie in this claustrophobic thing. It's actually fun. I usually get the best sleep in there, but it's not, not necessarily as fun. It's definitely not the perfect place. Like David mentioned, the environment should be conducive to creativity. Imagine that. It's like the complete opposite. So we had a huge challenge. How do we make people at least think or do something creative inside the scanner so that we can measure their brain activity and say, aha, this region is activated and this person is doing something creative? So we wanted to have something that engages the participants, that allow free expression, spans over different domains, like Jyoti mentioned, divergent thinking and conversion thinking and so on, have a game and fun-like environment, and also useful outcome in the end. So because I love Pictionary so much, I thought, that's it, that's the answer. Pictionary game, think about it. You have to know your material. It's a tablet kind of thing. You're lying down, you're drawing. It's a game. You're designing it for somebody else. Somebody else has to guess the word. So basically what people then did is they lie down in the scanner, and it's an improvisation-based exercise. They have 1 minute, draw the word. If you don't know the game, raise your hand. It's pretty easy. So everybody knows, right? It's a social game. We play with friends if we have friends. And so the idea, or VR, whatever you like, and the idea is that you have very less time, you have to come up with this solution, which you can then rate whether the solution was good or bad, whether you can guess the word or not, basically, and how many elements people use, how unique the solution was, and so on and so forth. So here I'm just giving an example of three pictures that people came up with the three for the word elevate. So you can see that rising up, magician or no, or just meditation can do it too, apparently. And we designed these MR-safe tablets so that people can go inside the scanner and actually draw these things. Great. So talking about the results. So again, just talking about the first time point, before the training, did the training two groups, language and creativity, and post time point, how the brain activity changed. So it's very interesting. David mentioned this idea of unconscious processing, which is, I think, what we kind of sort of also found. And I think we are probably the first study which actually did find the effects of changes in creativity inside the brain. So here are the differences we found. We found that so blue is after training, red line is before training, and this is the creative group, this is the language group. And when, during the time they're playing the game of Pictionary, we found that activity in the prefrontal regions, especially those blobs that you see highlighted there, reduced. So there was deactivation during the task. So we found reduced engagement of prefrontal regions. Prefrontal regions are more commonly known for planning and worrying. And basically planning and conscious monitoring and stuff like that. So what we find is with Grace's training, with more creative gym, we find a reduction in these activities without a drop in their performance. Actually, the task performance improved. So where they're getting better at the task and they are getting more creative and they have reduced activation of the brain activity in the prefrontal regions. But the next question was, if that's going down, something must also go up. Like, what's actually helping them to be creative? And the answer comes from actually the part of the brain called little brain, or cerebellum, which sits down here. That has been considered as some part of the unconscious processing of the brain. So the idea is, like David mentioned, if you tell somebody to hit a ball with a baseball bat, but you tell them, okay, please make sure you say every step as you hit it, even the best players cannot do it, because you can't think and true. But what happens is you just do this because you just somehow know in your gut how to hit the ball at the right time. And that's where cerebellum kicks in. So for the most part of the last century, people thought cerebellum is only for motor learning and how do you do the task properly. For example, if you're learning how to hit the ball with a bat, cerebellum will help you learn it much faster because it can parallelize. It's like a graphics unit in your brain. It can parallelize and synthesize in many different ways so you can learn it as quickly as possible. Interestingly, the cerebellum, it doesn't matter whether it's a motor signal or it's an idea. So it can do the same thing with the idea. If you have an idea, it can parallelize it similar different ways and come up with an answer. So you may have heard of this thing, aha. It usually happens in the showers. It has nothing to do with hot water. Maybe it does somehow. But the idea is the cerebellum is somehow helping and kicking in and giving the ha-ha moment because it has been working on it. And that's what we found. We found that the cerebellar connectivity with the prefrontal regions went up, meaning cerebellum was doing what prefrontal was supposed to do while it was down. And that helped enhance their creativity. We also found that these reductions in prefrontal activity actually beautifully followed the dose-response relationship, meaning even though the training was supposed to be 10 hours, in some cases, they couldn't show up or something. So they had 8 hours or 7 hours of training. And the more training they got, the more response we got in terms of brain activity. That clearly shows that the training had something to do with it. Now, that said, is 10 hours enough? I don't know. Maybe 20 is better. But the idea is maybe continually practicing it like going to a gym is the best thing. So to quickly summarize, we were able to find the effects of training in behavior and in the brain functioning such that there was reduced engagement of prefrontal activity, but more enhanced involvement of spontaneous implicit processing through the cerebellar connectivity. I'll go to Grace, getting a mic fixed, for the future work. We have a lot of stuff we're doing in Stanford now, including these four things, and she'll give you a quick overview of the two things, which are really exciting, I think.
So we've been at this for 5 years, and some of the offshoots and some of other kind of areas of interest that have been seeded from our work is developing a next-gen 21st century assessment, which we'll talk about a little bit more. Kind of the concept which is so apropos for this forum and kind of this event, which is analog versus digital. Team creativity, kind of how does collaboration affect or impact the act of creativity, and then also in K-12, in a developing mind that's still growing, how is creativity kind of affected during the middle school slump? So the two that we're gonna kind of point to a little bit more closely is this idea of a method of assessing creative capacity in the 21st century. So Manish mentioned the Torrance test that was developed, in the early 60s, 50s? And that, I mean, it's a little old school, right? It kind of determines or measures if somebody possesses creative characteristics. But just think, if you're a genius in your closet, like, why does that matter? So for us at the D School, we always talk about, fine, we're transforming these people, but what are they gonna go do in the world? How are they gonna activate what they know? So we designed or prototyped this new creativity assessment called the Design Thinking Creativity Test. And what it's trying to do is assess a person's ability to activate their creative capacity in a real world setting. And we think that's next gen. We think that's very applicable to kind of, I guess, what I think the world needs to solve today's messy problems. It's very analog, it's very subjective. It's not a bubble test by any means. And so it's extremely complex in terms of how we normalize a grading scale and et cetera. And then we'll close with this, which Manish and I were talking about. Well, we had this really great quote, which we didn't put up, but we just want to end with a question. Analog versus digital. It was mentioned in today's keynote and I guess yesterday about retaining the humanity in technology. So our question is our humanity, which is our capacity to be creative, to be empathetic, to empathize, is that endangered by our oversaturation with technology? And we think, you know, given, we talk about a touch, we're labeling this the touch gap, because, I mean, I bear a torch for analog and real human experience, because I think that is what really develops our intuition, that is what makes us human. And so with that, we will leave you with this question. Anything else?
The last slide, just thanking our team and the funding agencies, and that's it. If you have a question, you can feel free to email us. Thank you.
Thank you.